नमस्ते बिटिया, हमेशा खुश रहो बिटिया। आई एम डॉक्टर भारत शर्मा, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ पैथोलॉजी, फैकल्टी ऑफ होम्योपैथिक साइंस, ज्योति विद्यापीठ, वुमेन्स यूनिवर्सिटी, जयपुर। टुडेज टॉपिक इज शॉक। शॉक इज ए लाइफ थ्रेटनिंग क्लिनिकल सिंड्रोम ऑफ कार्डियोवैस्कुलर कोलैप्स कैरेक्टराइज्ड बाय एन एक्यूट रिडक्शन ऑफ इफेक्टिव सर्कुलेटिंग ब्लड volume, that is hypotension, and an inadequate perfusion of cells and tissue cause hypoperfusion. Thus, by definition, true or secondary shock is a circulatory imbalance between oxygen supply and oxygen requirements at the cellular level and is also called as circulatory shock and is the type which is commonly referred as shock if not specified. Classification and etiology. Although in a given clinical case, two or more factors may be involved in causation of true shock, a simple etiological classification of shock syndrome divided it into following three major types and a few other variants. First is hypovolemic shock. This form of shock results from inadequate circulatory blood volume by various etiological factors that may be either from the loss of red cell mass and plasma due to hemorrhage or from the loss of plasma volume alone. Now, second is cardiogenic shock. Acute circulatory failure with sudden fall in cardiac output from acute disease of the heart without actual reduction of blood volume results in cardiogenic shock. Septic shock. Severe bacterial infections or septicemia induce septic shock. It may be the result of gram-negative septicemia or, which more common and less commonly, gram-positive septicemia, exotoxic shock. Other types are traumatic shock, neurogenic shock, and hypoadrenal shock. Now, pathogenesis. In general, all forms of shocks involve following three derangements: reduce effective circulating blood volume, reduced supply of oxygen to the cell and tissue with resultant anoxia, and inflammatory mediators and toxin release from shock-induced cellular injury. These derangements initially set in compensatory mechanism, but eventually a vicious cycle of cell injury and severe cellular dysfunction lead to breakdown of organ function. Pathogenesis of hypovolemic shock or hypovolemic shock occurs from inadequate circulating blood volume due to various causes, most often from loss of red cell masses due to hemorrhage and therefore also called as hemorrhagic shock. The major effect in this are due to decreased cardiac output and low intracardiac pressure. Pathogenesis of cardiogenic shock. Cardiogenic shock result from a severe left ventricular dysfunction from various causes such as acute myocardial infarction. The resultant decreased cardiac output has its effect in the form of decreased tissue perfusion and movement of fluid from pulmonary vasculature bed into pulmonary interstitial space, initially interstitial pulmonary edema, and later into alveolar abscess causing alveolary pulmonary edema. Pathogenesis of septic shock. Septic shock result most often from gram-negative bacteria entering the body from genitourinary tract, alimentary tract, respiratory tract or skin, and less often from gram-positive bacteria. In septic shock, there is immune system activation and severe systemic inflammatory response to the infection. The net result of above mechanism is vasodilation and increased vascular permeability. In septic shock, profound peripheral vasodilation and pooling of blood causes hyperdynamic circulation in septic shock. In contrast to hypovolemic and cardiogenic shock, increased vascular permeability causes development of inflammatory edema. Disseminated intravascular coagulation is prone to develop in septic shock due to endothelial cell injury by toxins. pathophysiology or stages of shock. Also, deterioration of the circulation in shock is a progressive and continuous phenomena, and compensatory mechanism become progressively less effective. Historically, shock has been divided arbitrarily into three stages: compensated or non-progressive or initial or reversible, shock in the early stage of shock, and attempt is made to maintain adequate cerebral and coronary blood supply by redistribution of blood so that the vital organ, brain and heart are adequately perfused and oxygenated. This is achieved by activation of various neurohormonal mechanisms causing widespread vasoconstriction and by fluid conservation by the kidney. Progressive decompensated shock. This is a stage when the patient suffers from some other stress or risk factors, that is pre-existing cardiovascular and lung disease. Besides persistence of the shock condition, this causes progressive deterioration. The effect of resultant tissue hypoperfusion in progressive decompensated shock are pulmonary hyperperfusion, pulmonary hypoperfusion, and tissue ischemia. Irreversible or decompensated shock, the third condition, when the shock is so severe that is in spite of compensatory mechanisms and despite therapy and control of etiologic agents which cause the shock, no recovery takes place. It is called decompensated or irreversible shock. Its effects due to widespread cell injury are as follows. First is progressive vasodilatation, increased vascular permeability, release of myocardial depressant factor, worsening of pulmonary hypoperfusion, anoxic damage to heart, kidney and brain, and hypercoagulability of blood. Morphological features. Eventually, shock is characterized by multisystem failure. The morphologic changes in shock are due to hypoxia, resulting in degeneration and necrosis in various organs. The major organ affected are the brain, heart, lung, and kidney, while morphological changes are also noted in the adrenal, gastrointestinal tract, liver, and other organs. Clinical features and complications. The classical features of decompensated shock are characterized by depression of four vital processes: very low blood pressure, subnormal temperature, feeble and irregular pulse, and shallow and shying respiration. In addition, the patient in shock have pale face, sunken eyes, weakness, cold, and clammy skin. Life-threatening complications in shock are due to the hypoxic cell injury, resulting in immunoinflammatory response and activation of various cascades, clotting, complement, and kinding system. These include the following: acute respiratory distress syndrome, disseminated intravascular coagulation, acute renal failure, and multi-organ dysfunction syndrome. With progression of the condition, the patient may develop stupor, coma, and finally death. This session is powered by Digital Version 2.0, Jyoti Vidyapeeth, Women's University. I hope you all enjoy this session. If you have any query, please mention it in comment box. Thank you.